Francis Bacon is a British artist with a lot of identity issues going on even before the war takes place. He's known as a controversial artist in his lifetime as well as today. And so we're going to see that in a lot of his work. Now, the thing to keep in mind is that he finds himself as an Irish Catholic who happens to also be homosexual. And this leads to huge identity issues in terms of his relationship to the church. He wants to be closer, but of course the church is kind of pushing him away because of his homosexuality, because of the way that he lives his life. And so we get these pieces that tend to have some allusion to religion in many cases, such as the one that you see here. This is an obvious allusion to, for example, the crucifixion. And yet there's always some ambiguity to it. There's always something there, sort of a calling to question. It's almost like he's creating conceptual art where it's not so much about the art, but the conversation that's going to be created in its wake. He also happens to have an affinity for both Diego Velázquez, who we talked about a few chapters ago, as well as the papacy. Of course, the papacy being the head of the Catholic Church, so that isn't terribly surprising. He has this love of Velázquez, and the interesting thing about Bacon is he's frequently going to copy Velázquez from prints of Velázquez, not from the originals. And so there's always this Xerox copy sort of idea going on where things are altered and changed, and sometimes it's clear and sometimes it's not. But here on the right, we have the so-called, or one of the so-called screaming popes based on a painting by Diego Velázquez. And here we get that idea of the papacy as potentially dangerous, as something that should be, well, here we have the fencing in front of it, something that should be separated from the viewer, should be kept away from the viewer. And of course, we always have those identity issues when we're dealing with Francis Bacon. So here in a triptych, he's dealing with some of those issues, depicting himself potentially in these various forms from three different angles. But then as you get closer, you get this sense of distortion. That's one of the beauties of Bacon, is when you look at his work from a distance, it looks fairly common. But as you get closer, there's always that element of a disturbed visual that comes out of nowhere. And with that in mind, let's look at his painting called Painting of 1946. And this is his reaction to World War II. Here we see a close-up. I'll get to that red circle in a minute. What he's done here is created an indictment of humanity and a reflection on war's brutality, not unlike the ideas of German New Objectivity, which we looked at a couple of chapters ago. The man in the center is this revolting image of a person with a vivid red stain on his upper lip, as if he's been consuming the flesh surrounding him. And let's explore that. As we look closer, you'll notice that that red stain isn't on his lip, that it almost gives the impression of a mustache. And add to that, that massive black umbrella. And what you get is this idea of Neville Chamberlain, the man who got off an airplane and said, "There will be peace in our time," because he had appeased Hitler. He had given in, and Hitler said, "No, no, no, I'm not going to have a war. Of course I'm not. You can trust me. I'm authoritarian." Anyway, it reflects Neville Chamberlain. The umbrella is also something that Chamberlain carried around. In fact, on the right, you'll notice he's got an umbrella over him, but he's also carrying one. He always had one. This was something every gentleman of the 1930s would have had. And so that figure in the painting is based on American and European political figures. And so as we look at it, because all of these politicians pretty much dress the same, they'd have the dark coat over the dark suit with the umbrella and everything else, we get that idea of the politicians eating something, in this case, people. And it's metaphorical. They're not actually eating people, presumably. But what they are doing is they're sending people's sons off to war. And they're running them through the meat grinder of war. and they're doing it without any risk to themselves. They're not sending their own children. They're not sending their close relatives off to the front lines. Sometimes you see wealthy and well-off people serving in the war, but it's always going to be somewhere where they're fairly safe. They're fairly secure. So he's getting at that idea of the politicians eating the people. Now, let's deal with two other issues. One is the curtains. You'll notice the pulled curtains in the background. They're pulled down, closing the room off. That's intentional because we don't want people seeing what's going on in the back rooms. We don't want people to know what the politicians are really up to. You'll also notice, once again, that we have this sort of fencing or gate running around, keeping us from that politician. We are told that he's kind of dangerous, potentially. And then there's one other thing that kind of stands out, and by kind of, I mean really stands out, and it's these hunks of flesh. And you're looking at them and going, is this bovine or human? What is this? That looks an awful lot like the end of a femur. This could be, you know, a human piece of a rib. This could be some kind of just sort of general chunk of meat. And is this a human or a cow that's been halved and possibly quartered? And what he's reflecting is this idea of a butcher shop, an old-fashioned butcher shop, the sort of thing he would have grown up with, that always have their meat on display. It's all out there for people to see. But of course, we know from that room, from Bacon's room in painting 1946, that those curtains are drawn. The idea being that the politicians behind the scenes are sending your children off to war, sending your friends off to war. They don't want anyone to see it. And they're fully aware of it. They know what's going on. And we find out later on, as you study the histories of World War II, that oftentimes the Allies knew when attacks were going to happen. We had the German Enigma machine and the Enigma codes. We had the Japanese naval codes. And yet sometimes we just let things happen because we didn't want to give it away. And so from a civilian perspective, that's disturbing. That's terrifying. So what he's done is he adds to the visceral impact of the painting with these flayed human carcasses in the background. This is an attempt to remake the violence of the reality of war itself, to remove the cloak and show the role of the politicians in the horrors that were World War II.